It is my very, very great pleasure to introduce Kathleen Jentleson to you and welcome her to Shelburne for the first time. Katie is the Merrie and Dan Boone Curator of Folk and Self-Taught Art at the High Museum of Art in Atlanta. That's southern Vermont. Yeah. Where her recent projects include the exhibitions Green Pastures in Memory of Thornton Dial, A Cut Above, Wood Sculpture from the Gordon W. Bailey Collection, and Fever Within, The Art of Ronald Lockett. Jentleson earned her doctorate in art history from Duke University in 2015. Her dissertation, Gatecrashers, the First Generation of Outsider Artists in America, examines how self-taught painters like Anna Mary Robertson Moses, John Cain, and Horace Pippin engaged and challenged diverse conceptions of American modernism in the years after World War I. She is speaking today on Goodwill Grandma, Anna Mary Robertson Moses, and Cold War Cultural Diplomacy. Please join me in welcoming Katie to Shelburne.
Good morning. Thank you so much to Tom and Karen for inviting me, and especially to all of you for being inside on this gorgeous day. And thanks to my fellow panelists. Jane, your talk was amazing. I learned so much, and I'm really excited to see the show and hear what Jamie has to say. Like I said, I'm learning so much already. I actually mentioned Grandma Moses's 100th birthday at the end of my talk. I didn't know that it happens here at the Shelburne Museum, and I'm really excited to tell you that I'm continuing that tradition because today is my birthday. So I'm really excited. Maybe we can stick a candle in one of those chocolate chip cookies. It's not my 100th birthday, as you might imagine, but nonetheless, I'm very happy to be here with you today talking about one of my favorite artists. So as Tom mentioned, I come to you from the High Museum of Art in Atlanta, where we have an entire department. Can you hear me okay, by the way? Okay. We have an entire department dedicated to self-taught artists there. And as you might guess, our depth is really in Southern material, and I'm very sad that we do not have any Moses in our collection. I hope to change that. And as many of you heard in Jane's talk, she spent many years in the South. So many that, as she put it, she had to fight long and hard against the Southern accent. So I'm hoping that we can make that connection with our audiences in the future. And before I arrived at the High, I was completing my dissertation, which Tom mentioned. It's called Gatecrashers, the First Generation of Outsider Artists in America. And it's a project that really looks at how and why self-taught artists like Moses first crashed the gates. That's how the press put it. They crashed the gates of the American art world before the Second World War. But my fascination with this important and often neglected tradition in American art really began when I was working as a journalist in New York. And I wandered into an exhibition at the Gallery Saint-Étienne, at Jane's Gallery, that was a revisiting of Sidney Janis's Watershed 1942 show, They Taught Themselves. It was a large survey of American self-taught artists that included Grandma Moses. And in addition to really loving the work that I saw there, I was really enthralled by an essay that Jane wrote for the show. It introduced the show, and it revealed to me something that I never knew before, which was that self-taught artists had once been considered key players in American modernism, but that chapter in American art history had largely been forgotten. So I was thrilled to go back to school and then to return to Gallery Saint-Étienne years later while I was getting my Ph.D. at Duke to conduct research in their tremendous Grandma Moses archives. And while I was there, just the revelations continued to roll. And I became really focused on the reception of Moses and her work amid the cultural politics of the Cold War era. And that's really what my talk is about today. So I'm going to focus on an exhibition of her work abroad in 1950, because the reaction to that show really perfectly illustrates how Moses fit into larger conversations about American art at that time. And it was really, as Tom kind of indicated at the beginning of the morning, it was really a time when American art critics and government officials longed for an American art that would carry national values abroad. But they really disagreed as to what those values were and who best represented them. So I'd like to begin in 1947 with a lamentation from Museum of Modern Art curator James Thrall Sobey. He wrote, We have produced in painting and sculpture no figure big enough to hold the eyes of the world upon himself. The title of Sobey's article, Does Our Art Impress Europe?, is emblematic of the self-consciousness that still plagued domestic art circles at mid-century. In his book, How New York Stole the Idea of Modern Art, Serge Guilbeault has famously argued that New York unseated Paris as a global art capital as early as 1948. But complaints like Sobey's on the sorry state of American art are easily traceable well into the 1950s. In the spring of 1953, for instance, MoMA organized 12 American modern painters and sculptors, which opened at the Musée d'Art Moderne in Paris. French critics were not enthusiastic about the show, which included work by Archil Gorky and Jackson Pollock. One critic commented, "It seems impossible that a big country and a great people cannot present something better." Later that year, in an essay aggressively titled Toward a New Definition of Chauvinism, Art Digest editor Bella Krasny complained of the inability of the French to see anything except French art. Krasny recounted her recent visit to the Musée d'Art Moderne, where Parisian chauvinism prevailed, with one highly deplorable exception. She writes, "Tucked away in the furthest corner of the museum, in a gallery almost too small to be noticed, I found a little cluster of works by non-Frenchmen. And here in this alien camp, I came across the one painting that represented the United States. A small painting, its placard reading, Grandma Moses, École Américaine. I hurried away because I dislike practical jokes on an international scale." While Moses' widespread popularity at home has been well documented and analyzed, the artist's exposure to European audiences after 1950 is a little studied aspect of her career. In my talk today, I'll offer an unprecedented look at Grandma Moses, the exhibition that introduced the artist abroad, traveling to five European cities between June of 1950 and January of 1951. In addition to presenting new archival findings that document the execution and reception of the show, I'll offer readings of key works that demonstrate the Cold War utility of Moses' imagery, ultimately leading to a reckoning with Moses' place in grand narratives of post-war American painting. For while Moses' paintings toured Europe in 1950, Peter Bloom's monumental magic realist painting, The Rock, won the People's Choice Award at the Carnegie International. And at the Venice Biennale the same year, the American Pavilion showcased not only Jackson Pollock and Willem de Kooning, but also John Marin, elder statesman of the Stieglitz Circle. Moses' 1950 European tour, and popularity more generally, exemplify the eclecticism of American art in mid-century, a historical reality that is often eclipsed in favor of monolithic narratives about the so-called triumph of abstract expressionism after World War II. On June 9, 1950, Grandma Moses, an exhibition of 50 paintings, opened at the Neue Gallery in Vienna. Organized by the Austrian-born, New York-based dealer Otto Collier, the exhibition was presented under the auspices of the Information Services Branch of the United States Forces in Austria, attracting 5,000 visitors in 4 weeks, which was a new record for a show at a private gallery in the city. From Vienna, it went to Salzburg's Künstlerhaus, where a senior representative of Information Services there declared the exhibition another great success, suggesting that it brought more goodwill for America than any other single effort we have made here. When the exhibition crossed the border into Switzerland, a Foreign Services official who helped organize the show at Bern's Kunsthal declared it pure gold as far as the interpretation of American culture was concerned. At its next stop, the Hague's Hemente Museum, the American ambassador to the Netherlands attended a special event for 100 Dutch grandmothers, one of whom gave him a doll dressed in traditional Zeeland costume to send back to Moses. And I was just talking to Jamie about whether that doll might be in the Bennington collection. Opening next at the American Embassy in Paris, the show's vernissage drew 280 people, including the chief curator of the Musée d'Art Moderne, who the following year would oversee the acquisition of Moses's The Dead Tree, which marked the museum's first addition of a contemporary American painting to its collection. Despite being supported by various government agencies, the Moses exhibition has never been before discussed in the context of Cold War cultural diplomacy. For one thing, Moses' tour occurred during a period that marked a relative downswing in government efforts to promote American painting abroad, which was caused by the catastrophic failure of the exhibition Advancing American Art several years earlier. And let me just pause here and say, for an artist or artwork to be included in this Cold War cultural diplomacy, you know, these exhibitions that the government was organizing, did not mean that that was the artist's intent. It did not mean that the artist was creating work to be shown abroad to express certain values about American, you know, American life and American stature in the world. It was utilized in that way by the government. So when we look, you know, over the course of this talk at Grandma Moses's paintings, and you know, speaking about some other artists who were very much kind of instrumentalized during this era, we don't want to think that this was Grandma Moses's intent. That her paintings necessarily be used in this way. It is something that, you know, just happened because they resonated so much with European audiences in the ways that government officials wished that European audiences would see life in America. So back to this show, which was catastrophically just a total disaster. While it was on view in Prague during the summer of 1947, this exhibition of contemporary American art was recalled by George Marshall, the Secretary of State under President Truman. And as most recent histories of Cold War cultural diplomacy tell it, the government did not publicly sponsor another major exhibition of American art abroad until the summer of 1951, but they really overlooked the Grandma Moses tour that I'm speaking about today. The exhibition included 50 paintings that Moses completed between 1938 and 1950. In its catalog, which was translated into three languages, Otto Kallir did not hesitate to position Moses as the most famous and popular painter in America. The catalog's cover featured only Moses' signature against a spare background, but several promotional posters featuring Moses' works were made for the tour. Hurricane at Home was the work selected for the Vienna poster, and it proved to be an apt choice as the show opened during a bout of extreme summer weather in the form of a heat wave that June. By the time the exhibition made its final stop in Paris in December, Kallir's co-organizer there, Dorothea Speyer, thought a snow scene more appropriate. She deemed Here Comes Aunt Judith, a scene depicting the gathering of kin before a snow-covered farmstead, seasonally appropriate for the City of Lights at Christmas time. Here Comes Aunt Judith offered European audiences more than just a holiday theme. It was a revelation of an American golden age of peace and agricultural prosperity. In the background of the work, a matriarch steps out of her trim farmhouse to chat with the postman, a significant figure in Moses' memories of art making, as one of her earliest works was allegedly a gift for her local postmaster at Christmas time. Around her, horses outfitted with seasonal bells arrive four female relatives, among them Aunt Judith, a fictional character who is perhaps a stand-in for one of Moses' many aunts. In the foreground, one young man pulls a felled Christmas tree before two carolers, while another engages with several figures and eyeing a fine coniferous specimen that still is standing. Inside the cattle pen at left, the everyday activity of farm life, the chopping of wood, the feeding and slaughtering of livestock maintains. Notably, the travel and labor commence without the aid of automobiles or the latest in farming equipment, and there is no trace of modern amenities like electricity or telecommunications. Although Moses' hometown of Eagle Bridge was a relatively remote hamlet, her daily life was hardly devoid of technology. As Carol and Marlene attests, she listened to the radio, sewed by the light of electric lamps, and enjoyed all the benefits that modern commerce brought to Eagle Bridge. Just as Paul Gauguin made the landscape and inhabitants of Brittany more primitive than they were when he painted them in the 1880s. And Here Comes Aunt Judith and the majority of her other works, Moses rendered the Cambridge Valley less modern than it actually was, foregoing details like the two interstates or railway that ran through the region by the first half of the 20th century. Moses may not have subscribed to the radical anti-modernism that led Gauguin to embellish the French countryside and later Tahiti as pre-modern paradise, but her painting was nonetheless connected to a worldview that privileged an earlier way of life. On her 95th birthday, Moses reflected, "In this age, I don't think people are as happy. They don't take time to be happy. They're worried. And I do think we have too much now. We did with much less." As the Moses works move through Europe, drawing record crowds and ample coverage from the European press, American critics hardly touched her triumph. A notable exception is a New York Times piece that Aileen Lusheim devoted to the Venice Biennale that had just opened across the Alps from the Moses show the same summer. Moses comes up only in passing in the midst of Lusheim's larger lamentation about the tepid response to the American Pavilion, which included selections from Willem de Kooning, Jackson Pollock, and a large show of works by John Marin. She writes, "Europeans like to think of Grandma Moses rather than Marin as representative of American art. They praise our naivete and integrity, especially in rodeos and westerns, but they begrudge us a full, sophisticated artistic expression. Grandma Moses represents both what they expect of us and what they are glad to grant us." In a letter from Paris published in the Magazine of Art several months later, the influential art historian and critic Robert Goldwater also criticized how the Moses show reinforced the primitivization of America. "This kind of thing can only strengthen the Parisian's tendency, with which he nowadays understandably would like to comfort himself, to think of the United States as a land of auto and tank producing peasants." Yet these dismissals of Moses fail to acknowledge the complexity of her reception abroad. Perhaps anticipating that American critics would assume the worst, Collier collected press clippings and visitor book testimonials from the European tour, preserving them for his scrapbooks and publishing many of the responses and several titles devoted to Moses after 1950. As Collier's excerpts evidence, European critics saw a wide variety of virtues in Moses's art. Comparing her to native sons like Bruegel and Pizarro, and praising her as capable of evoking the greatest realistic painters of all time. Moreover, to the extent that Moses did perpetuate certain European prejudices about uncivilized Americans, so too did she break down prevailing stereotypes about them, precisely with the "we did with much less" credo offered by paintings like Here Comes Aunt Judith. A critic for Graphie put a finer point on the effect that Moses's wood-burning stoves and horse-drawn carriages had in overturning European stereotypes about the United States. The American, and this is what he wrote, "The America Grandma Moses reveals to us is not yet Americanized. The popularity her art enjoys through the New World seemed to suggest that the American, even while borne forwards by the surge of progressive destiny, does not want to lose contact with a more meditative world." By offering a characterization of national life as rural and traditional, works like Here Comes Aunt Judith thus fulfilled a major objective of Cold War cultural diplomacy, which was the re-imaging of dollar-chasing Americans. For in the post-war period, the United States faced not only long-standing European bias that American culture was an oxymoron, but also the onslaught of anti-Western Soviet propaganda. By 1947, U.S.-Soviet relations had soured, and while the Soviet Union could not rival the economic strength and nuclear capacity of the United States in the immediate post-war period, Stalin's regime initiated a superior front in the battle for men's minds. As neither Austria nor Switzerland had signed with the newly founded North Atlantic Treaty Organization, or NATO, the first three cities to host Grandma Moses in Vienna, Salzburg, and Bern were ground zero for the cultural front of the dueling superpowers. Donald C. Dunham, the foreign services officer who helped Collier organize the Bern showing, acknowledged this in a letter to Collier in which he delineates his intention to use the creative products of Grandma Moses as illustrations of the core of our national character, which we are endeavoring to articulate in opposition to the efforts of the communists. Ironically, the U.S. Army report that documented the success of the Moses show in Vienna noted that at least one communist newspaper there, Volkszeitung, endorsed the Moses show, encouraging amateur painters to seek its lessons in simplicity and effect. And when Moses had her first show in Moscow in 1964, a U.S. embassy official there reported to Collier that there were lines of people waiting to see it on several occasions. While Moses's agrarian imagery and equalizing life story could be seen as harmonizing with communist values and art doctrine, given the mass commercialization of her artwork, her career was more comfortably allied with capitalism. The European tour included examples of Moses manufactures such as greeting cards and textiles, but they do not appear to have caused reproach. Yet the Dutch response included an indictment of the show as an embodiment of hegemonic American greed for other reasons. After receiving overwhelmingly positive reviews from Vienna, Bern, and Salzburg, Collier was astonished to see the show become a focal point for attacks against America when it opened at the Hague's Hementa Museum. He warned his co-organizer in Paris, the show's next stop, of the Dutch press's unexpectedly negative response. He wrote, "The line followed in almost all of the big write-ups is that America has the money to buy everything, including publicity, but that the American money will never be able to bribe Holland to accept the American culture. Culture, they maintain, is in Europe, technical progress and money in America." Although Collier was mortified by what was passed on to him from the Dutch papers, his Dutch contacts tried to mollify him. An officer of the U.S. Information Service there reassured him that the goodwill created by the Grand Mamma's exhibit far outweighed minor criticisms, which appeared in certain of the press, and went on to characterize the overall reaction to her work as gezellig, meaning cozy, warm, and friendly. I'd like to focus for a moment on the gezellig quality of Moses's painting, another important dimension of her power at mid-century. For while reimagining America, especially with regard to counteracting communist propaganda, was paramount, comfort was another important objective of Cold War cultural diplomacy. The notion that art could provide a source of palliative respite in the midst of global turmoil was longstanding and hardly an invention of the US government. Just as London's National Gallery of Art offered lunchtime piano concerts during the Blitz, so too were Moses's paintings presented and received as a form of spiritual oasis in European cities ravaged by World War II. A critic for Arts Paris seized on this, writing, "It is a great pleasure to walk through such an exhibition where the soul is devoted to the peaceful life in the quiet streets or in the warm interiors, in the midst of animals running loose or women working quietly. Thanks go to Grandma Moses for the happiness which she shows us." Of the 40 works on display in Paris that Christmas time, none better encompasses how Moses's art could serve as what Lloyd Goodrich called a fallout shelter for the human spirit than over the river to Grandma's house. The placid winter scene follows a red sleigh as it travels a short but joyful distance between two inviting farmsteads. The point of departure is the house of the younger generation, larger and more handsome, with its dark wood siding and high sloping roof, whereas the destination, Grandma's house, is an older, more modest construction, but no less welcoming, with its door ajar and chimney smoking. As in Here Comes Aunt Judith, Grandma is already outside, greeting the postman, with her back turned to the imminent arrival of her beloved offspring. Crossing over the river, the sleigh passes by a hunter and a game of hockey on the frozen river below. Even though the scene is viewed from a great distance, the frame around it is tight, creating an insular feeling in which the only road leads home in both directions. The painting is titled for the most well-known series of verses from Lydia Maria Child's 1844 poem, The New England Boy's Song About Thanksgiving Day. And it is also a reference to Moses's personal family tradition of going to her grandmother King's house every November. Despite its particularities to Moses's family ritual and an exclusively American holiday, the painting would have appealed to anyone who had ever joyfully anticipated the warmth of hearth and family on a cold winter's day. Indeed, the universal quality of Moses's work, which is something that Jane mentioned earlier, is something that came up again and again throughout her European reception. The ambassador to the Netherlands reported that even though most Netherlanders are not familiar with our New England countryside, they found the paintings of Moses homey. Snow plays an important function in generalizing her landscapes, providing a blank canvas on which a viewer may project, or a viewer of a variety of nationalities could project memories of familiar topographies. Moses' works were also capable of drawing such projections because of how they offer leagues of miniaturized avatars in appealingly distant landscapes. Jane Collier has characterized Moses' sphere as a paper doll world, which demands the role of the imagination similar to that found in Child's Play. Her viewers are invited to finish the story. In her chapter on the miniature, literary theorist Susan Stewart analyzes the toy as a device for fantasy, which once it becomes animated, initiates another world, a world of daydream. The miniature figures in Moses' paintings thus trigger the imagining of oneself in an alternate universe that is protected from the contamination of everyday reality, which at the time of their showing to European audiences was traumatic and bleak. Still not recovered from the destruction of World War II, the countries where Moses' work was shown were already bracing for the new conflicts of the nuclear era. One army official noted that the opening of the Moses show in Vienna coincided with the escalation of the conflict in Korea, such that Austrians came bearing dark questions. Works like Over the River to Grandma's House and Here Comes Aunt Judith denied the post-war aftermath of bombed out cities and scorched bodies, offering the potential to escape, at least momentarily, into a soothing fantasy of a pre-traumatic past. President Truman was in office at the time of Moses' European tour. And he was a vocal skeptic of modern art who compelled the recall of the controversial Advancing American Art exhibition from Prague, describing its contents as the vaporings of half-baked lazy people and dismissing paintings like Yasuo Kuniyoshi's Circus Girl Resting with remarks like, if that's art, I'm a Hottentot. Furthermore, Truman could not countenance American abstraction, which he notoriously compared to a scrambled breakfast platter by calling it ham and eggs art. While Truman was dismissive of most strains of contemporary painting, he became the first of Grandma Moses' many presidential fans. The two met in 1949 when the president presented Moses with an award from the National Women's Press Club for outstanding accomplishment in art. In 1952, Arnold Newman photographed Truman's daughter, Margaret, for a feature in which interior decorator William Paulman matched five socialites with backgrounds that can reflect and set off the individual. The interiors range from Baroque elegance to provincial comfort, with Miss Truman seated between an antique pine clock and a modern Shaker chair, with a Moses painting hanging in the background to conjure the American look. 2 months later, Life ran a portfolio of photographs of White House interiors redecorated by the Trumans in Georgian fashion, with sumptuous wallpapers, draperies, and portraits of former presidents. Otto Collier was attentive, I'm just going to skip ahead here, to the Trumans' well-publicized White House makeover, and he wrote to them offering to dedicate an original painting by Grandma Moses to the American people. The Trumans accepted Collier's gift of July 4th, a painting of an Independence Day parade that Moses had recently completed. This overtly patriotic work remained in the White House collection when Truman left office in 1953, but by that point he had also added a Moses to his personal collection that returned to Missouri with him. Until well after Truman's death, Moses' The Plantation hung above the family piano, a fitting place given that Moses famously entreated the president to play for her during the tea following the National Press Club event in 1949. Pictures of Moses and Truman monopolized the media coverage of the Press Club event, despite the major achievements of her fellow awardees, who included former First Lady and Chair of the United Nations First Council on Human Rights, Eleanor Roosevelt, as well as Dorothy McCullough Lee, the first female mayor of a major American city with a population of over 500,000. Although there is little direct evidence that members of the American art world resented the support for Moses that emanated from the Oval Office, there was palpable anxiety about government officials supporting only figurative painting with patriotic overtones. Moses' July 4th, the work that entered the White House collection under Truman, and was issued as a commemorative stamp under Richard Nixon, fits this profile. The work depicts an Independence Day parade that pours out of a town hall into a landscape staked with billowing flags. While such overtly nationalistic conduct was appropriate or was beloved in the Depression era and also during wartime, and was indeed really seen as a strength for many self-taught painters like John Cain and Horace Pippin, who painted American presidents like George Washington and Abe Lincoln, by the late 1940s, it had become suspect. Fear of Nazi and Soviet art policies loomed large, as did a critique of federally supported art from the New Deal era. Responses to a 1949 roundtable on the state of American art convened by the Magazine of Art resounded with such concerns. Lionel Trilling, for instance, warned that all nationalistic theories of art are exclusive and repressive because they dangerously promulgate a belief in special moral virtue of the native point of view. The role that a painting's content played in expressing national character the ever-elusive Holy Grail sought by American artists since the 19th century onward, I guess even before, had always been a divisive issue in the art world. The most extreme exponents of the American scene, the regionalist triumvirate of Thomas Hart Benton, John Stuart Curry, and Grant Wood, who insisted that a native school depended on native subject matter, for instance, were championed by the nationalist art critic Thomas Craven, but roundly criticized by figures like Alfred Barr Jr., the founding director of the Museum of Modern Art. By the late 1940s, art historians, critics, and curators seemed nearly unanimous that there was something chauvinistic and shadowy about regionalism. Art historian H.W. Janssen, author of the famous Janssen art history books, has been credited with sounding the movement's death knell in a May 1946 article that equated regionalism with deviant mass politics. Born in Russia and trained in Hamburg before fleeing Germany in 1933, Janssen was disturbed by the parallels, not only between regionalism and the state-mandated art of totalitarian regimes, but also by the way those policies seemed to be embraced by public opinion. A vast majority of the American public, given a choice in the, and this is him writing, I'm sorry. A vast majority of the American public, given a choice in the matter, would agree with the policies of the Reichskulturkammer. Here, as in Germany, the man in the street regards the modern artist as a crazy, morbid charlatan, he wrote. Therefore, the danger lay not merely with the conservative tastes of the politicians in power, be they the Moses-loving Truman or a far more vocal enemy of modernism, Senator George Dondero, but also with the public. Janssen was among the 15 participants invited to discuss modern art by Life magazine in a 1948 roundtable, whose very conceit was the existence of an ahistorical gap between the general public and contemporary art. The panel drew a wide variety of voices, from the avant-garde critic Clement Greenberg to the notoriously conservative director of the Metropolitan Museum of Art, Francis Taylor, and those two faced off over the wisdom of the crowd in a particularly tense moment. As a means of describing art's potential for communicability, Taylor brought up the 50,000 visitors who stormed the Met to see the 19th century genre paintings of William Sidney Mount several years earlier. In a reply that was a thinly veiled attack on the American scene, Greenberg said, "I think those people who came only because the pictures were concerned with locales they knew showed a reprehensible attitude towards art. You can't cater to that attitude." When Taylor challenged Greenberg's knee-jerk disdain for the good opinion of 50,000 people, Greenberg shot back, "Are we going to judge truth by quantity and sheer mass?" Greenberg continued to take aim at the common man in a similar roundtable printed in the Magazine of Art a year later. In fact, Greenberg had been vilifying the effect of the middle class on art since his iconic essay published 10 years earlier, Avant-Garde and Kitsch. And in his Magazine of Art response, he emphasized the severity and ahistoric nature of the crisis he first outlined there. This is what he wrote. "Public taste seems eclectic because it now contains strata of varying degrees of cultivation and because there has been a breakdown of cultural authority. Socially and culturally unified in a former time, the art public since the 19th century has been expanded to receive a middle class that becomes less and less willing to abide by the judgment of connoisseurs. People are no longer so ashamed as they used to be of bad taste. Rather, without going to the trouble to improve it, they now defend it aggressively. Today, the art public asks expressly not to be made conscious of its own inadequacy." Moses's audience, with their appetite for her pleasing public appearances and affordable reproductions, mass-produced culture that fell easily into Greenberg's category of kitsch, represented precisely the self-assured middle-class tastes that Greenberg detested. The nature of her network and mechanisms of her market are also an illustration of the decentralization of cultural authority that he decries. There is no question that Moses successfully crashed the gates of the art world, appearing at inner sanctum institutions like MoMA and the Carnegie Museum of Art, but her presence inside the ivory tower was dwarfed by her ubiquity beyond it. Her image and paintings entering American homes through the mail slot, the television, the radio, and the department store. Despite the degree to which Moses fit the profile of the middle-class cultural idol that Greenberg feared, he never mentions her in his many diatribes against mass taste. This is consistent with the larger trend of Moses' absence from such contemporary debates about the status quo in modern and American art as those discussed here. Although the very realities on which certain dimensions of her success hinged, middle-class audiences and the forces that catered to them, were spoken about at length, Moses herself was like an elephant in the room, but in the form of an old lady who nobody, not even Greenberg, seemed to want to villainize. But in 1950, the same year as her European debut, James Thrall Sobey, the curator of painting at MoMA, and I began this talk with his lamentation about American art, he took Moses on in an essay entitled A Bucolic Pass and a Giddy Jungle. Sobey had witnessed the trouble that the cult of the modern primitive, which is what self-taught artists were called in this era frequently, he'd witnessed the trouble that this interest in the modern primitive could cause firsthand as he came on at MoMA in 1943 when Alfred Barr resigned in the aftermath of a poorly received show for the self-taught painter Morris Hirschfeld. So it's perhaps not surprising that he opens his essay with a very stark salvo. We are, and this is what he writes, we are in, I fear, for a period of unhealthy interest in normalcy, so far as the public's acceptance of the arts is concerned. By this I mean that more and more people, revolted that their civilizations should so soon be in anguish, grow impatient with artists who propose something new, strange, or troubled, instead of familiar and happy. There could be no clearer indication of this state of affairs than the fame of Grandma Moses. Sobey thus calls into question the very propagandist equality of Moses' painting that made them such appealing sanctuaries of respite during the Cold War. He was not objecting to the way that Moses came to reinforce stereotypes about American naivete abroad, although he did publish this in November of 1950 while the Moses Show was in The Hague. To the contrary, Sobey was receptive to the lyric freshness and emotional intensity of great popular art, whose most laudable practitioner he identified as Henri Rousseau. But he opposed Rousseau's giddy jungles to Moses' bucolic past. For Sobey, the danger of Moses was not in the works themselves, but rather in how their popularity precluded the acceptance of less sanguine art. He wrote, Moses' fame has occurred at a time when the deeper manifestations of popular art are frequently condemned as decadent. We are asked to accept as proper material for painting joy, but not sorrow, reflection, but not discovery, confidence, but not final confession, calm, and not violence. For Sobey, the fault is not so much with Moses as with her adoring layman viewer, whose own nostalgia for an almost vanished bucolic simplicity commands him to revel in Moses and revile those artists with less sunny outlooks. So in effect, the capacity of Moses' paintings for offering a kind of anti-anxiety therapy that made them so effective as good Cold War tactics rendered them, in Sobey's eyes, a menace to the proliferation of diverse artistic tastes at home. In Jerome Hill's 1950 Moses documentary, to which Sobey's essay is partially a response, narrator Archibald MacLeish dotingly contrasts Moses with those artists who paint trouble. Unlike Greenberg, who advocated for artists who believed that the only way to paint the trouble of mid-century was through the extraction of all pictorial content, Sobey backed painters associated with romantic or lyrical realism, such as William Kerner and Peter Bloom, both of whom took up the devastation of fascism and war quite recognizably in their paintings. The same year that Sobey condemned Moses, he gave a paper at the annual conference at the College Art Association celebrating Bloom's recently finished magnum opus, The Rock. Bloom described the painting to Life magazine as depicting the continual process of man's rebuilding out of a devastated world. Indeed, there is an optimism in the industrious labors of its subjects and the surging organic life around the decimated central structure that is the painting's namesake and focal point. Yet the monumental canvas is also a record of destruction and decay, a stark contrast to the undisrupted snowfalls and lush green pastures of Moses' body of work. Another obvious difference between Moses and Bloom was their approach to art. Whereas Moses was an efficient and prolific artist, Bloom's preparations for The Rock, which took him nearly a decade and one nervous breakdown to finish, were epic and exhaustive. Life emphasized the arduousness of Bloom's process with the headline, The Rock. Artists worked on it for 7 years. Several months after the story ran, writer Eloise Berengan published an amusing poem that contrasted the angsty and sluggish Bloom with the plucky and efficient Moses in The New Yorker. It takes 7 years for my art to bloom, said Peter Bloom to Grandma Moses. Four pictures at once uses paint in large doses, said Grandma Moses to Peter Bloom. "I've symbols for sorrow and symbols for doom," said Peter Bloom to Grandma Moses. "Never heard of Freud, don't believe in neurosis," said Grandma Moses to Peter Bloom. "Man gropes toward the stars from the edge of the tomb," said Peter Bloom to Grandma Moses. "Man proposes, but God disposes," said Grandma Moses to Peter Bloom. A year later, the New Yorker presented Moses as the, the New Yorker also presented Moses as the antithesis to the modern artist, this time in comic form. A woman, probably Lee Krasner, ribs her partner, probably Jackson Pollock, who is paralyzed before a blank canvas. She tells him, "Grandma Moses doesn't get into a funk. Grandma Moses doesn't have to wait for creative yeast. Grandma Moses isn't hamstrung by the tensions of her time. Grandma Moses knocks them out one after another. Grandma Moses." For decades, this punchline has prevailed. And Moses has more often been considered the foil to Jackson Pollock than his peer. Indeed, there are many reasons to interpret Moses's popular appeal as oppositional to rarefied abstract expressionism, from her friendship with President Harry Truman, a vocal skeptic of modern art, to the many voices in the mainstream media that cast her as a kind of anti-modern shepherdess, who would, as one art writer put it, lead us out of the lanes of abstraction and intellectualized distortion. And as we've seen today, the propagandistic and therapeutic qualities of Moses's works, which made them such effective bearers of goodwill abroad, also caused many critics at home to banish them from their emergent canons of American modernism. For these reasons, Moses has never qualified in contemporary art criticism or the histories of the period as the big figure that the American art world was still seeking at mid-century, despite her post-war ubiquity, which even Clement Greenberg had to acknowledge. In a 1962 article, Greenberg wrote, "Abroad, Grandma Moses's pictures used to stand for Native American art, and one of her landscapes was the first American work acquired by the Musée d'Art Moderne in Paris. Now, however, European critics dwell on how unmistakably Pollock's untutored barbaric force, which supposedly violates the rules that Grandma Moses still observes, conveys the youthful energies and recklessness of a people still unschooled in the traditions and refinements of art." In the above passage, Greenberg narrated the relationship between Moses and Pollock as one of succession, or rather displacement, which is consistent with Greenberg's "all roads lead to Pollock" narrative. Yet Greenberg was too quick to declare that Moses' popularity with foreign audiences was a thing of the past. Again, he wrote this in 1962, and as he was making this pronouncement that Pollock was, quote, "in Europe, the first and only genuinely American cultural hero since Walt Whitman," there was another Moses show opening at the same time, touring 18 European cities. This was something else Moses and Pollock had in common. In addition to their unprecedented capacities to attain artistic celebrity at home, they were the first American artists to have internationally traveling post-mortem retrospectives immediately following their deaths. Pollock in 1958, and Moses in 1962. It must also be noted that Moses's popularity both preceded and outlived the so-called triumph of abstract expressionism. She debuted in New York more than half a decade before events that put the third generation of American abstract painters on the map really happened. And 4 years later, in 4 years after Life magazine ran the news of Pollock's fatal car crash under the headline, "Rebel Artist Tragic Ending," Grandma Moses appeared on the magazine's cover, wreathed in roses and celebrating her 100th birthday, apparently here at the Shelburne. When Moses' position in relation to trends in mid-century American painting, if she is at all, she tends to land on one side of these binary polarities that plague the classification of art in this period and beyond: outsider or insider, figurative or abstract, atavistic or modern, popular or avant-garde. But in addition to being overly simplistic, these binaries also implied that one is transcendent, when in fact the post-war period is increasingly understood as a time of plurality and simultaneity. While other artists press codes of representation to their extreme, Grandma Moses painted only what she, a centenarian in 1960, could claim to know, producing an art that is no less linked to the mediation of mid-century anxiety than the wild abstraction of her peer, Jackson Pollock. Thank you.
Lisa.
You, it seems that from what you said that most Europeans like Grandma Moses because, under the critics, she was a bad artist. She was primitive, she was, this is the old sentiment. How did they react with, but she was terribly popular. Would they react to, say, Norman Rockwell in the same way?
Well, I don't think that they were embracing her because she was a bad artist. That was how the American critics were putting it. They were, you know, they were getting frustrated and saying, you know, Europe only wants to see American artists primitive. But in reality, for one thing, Europeans embraced self-taught artists before Grandma Moses, because of course Henri Rousseau, you know, was a famous French painter who became very popular in avant-garde circles in the first decade of the 20th century and had kind of primed European audiences to the greatness that can come from self-taught, untrained painters. So it wasn't so much that they were, you know, thought she was a bad painter and that's why they celebrated her. And part of what I was trying to get at was that there was a true complexity to what they were connecting with in her painting. Part of it was that she represented this kind of, you know, association of American culture with being untutored and being non-academic, which Europeans always have held over, you know, American artists' heads. But part of it was also, again, this kind of universal quality of her work that they could connect with in a time of great upheaval. And many of them also did, many of these critics also even connected her work with some of their greatest painters. You know, and thinking about some of the points that Jane made, you know, about the way that Moses was using kind of color theory and that sort of thing, you know, French critics were seeing that in her work. So I don't want you all to walk away with that sense that European audiences thought she was a bad artist, because they thought many things about her. And the problem with American art critics at home was that they were just assuming the worst, and they were unhappy with this kind of representation, this sole representation. And they were angry that the other, you know, avant-garde painters like Jackson Pollock weren't getting this kind of reaction from Europe. They were incredibly frustrated. And so they kind of, you know, put it into a box why European audiences were connecting with her. But there was a second part to your question, which I'm...
How would they have evaluated
Norman Rockwell? Right. Well, it's kind of interesting because there's a lot going on. I can't speak specifically to Norman Rockwell. Does anybody know about the reception of Norman Rockwell abroad? But I do know that as part of this kind of rethinking of what happened at mid-century and undoing of Clement Greenberg's whole idea that abstract expressionism came and just blew everything out of the water, there's a realization that in Europe, abstract expressionism was actually not as popular as pop art was about a decade later. Pop art, yeah. And so that kind of, you know, Norman Rockwell, obviously not a pop artist, but this kind of, you know, openness and excitement about art that had these kind of ties to popular culture was certainly something that proliferated in Europe in the post-war period more than we acknowledge, I think, because we have for so long kind of clung to this narrative that it was abstract expressionism and only abstract expressionism that made Europe finally respect American art.
I have a question about the audiences for Grandma Moses's work. And
really?
Okay.
Fine. So, here in America, when I think of who goes to art museums, it's usually a rarefied group. It's not the average Joe. Huh. Now, when we talk about her reception in Europe and those capital cities or other major European cities in the 1950s and beyond, who was seeing her work? Yeah. Was it Mr. and Mrs. coming in from the chalet to check it out, or was it the well-to-do, highly educated? Because I think it matters who the audience is.
Right.
I mean, people had Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers in these glamorous locales dancing. It wasn't that America was this agrarian culture. They knew that we had more.
Right.
So could you address the types of people who went and maybe still go to art museums over there?
I'm not an expert in you know, European art attendance, but I do think that, I mean, the show that I was specifically talking about happened, you know, in a private gallery in Austria, and then in a few public museums in Germany and Switzerland, And then at the American Embassy, actually, in Paris. So I think that maybe the Embassy show in particular drew a different kind of crowd than an art museum necessarily would have. But the Embassy is still a pretty, you know, blocked off place, not exactly open to the general public in the same way. But I think what came out of what I read about the reception is just that the show was setting record numbers. So it was drawing in, you know, both of those kinds of the profile of visitors that you outlined, the you know, middle class to upper middle class folks who have, you know, educations in art history or seek them out, and then also a whole new audience, because that was really what was coming out of the reports that I was reading, was that it was just record breaking attendance figures. So I do think that it got out of that rarefied audience a bit. Yeah, thank you. Yeah.
I think this is a very transitional moment in European museum, the history of European museums. If you think about 50, 51, 52, those of you who traveled in Europe or knew Europe in the early 50s, many of these cities are being entirely rebuilt.
Yeah.
Socially, architecturally. So by the 60s, museums in Europe are, you know, purported to be quite democratic compared to what they were before the war, but the area you're talking about, I think,
yeah, no, I think that's absolutely right.
People were desperate to see almost anything after the war.
Right, and because the government was involved, it was being promoted in a way that, you know, went beyond the kind of art museum's mechanisms for promotion, because this was being embraced as a kind of Cold War cultural diplomacy. You know, these publics who were in pain and suffering were being encouraged to come to these galleries and these museums in a way that was not standard, I think. That was truly exceptional in this moment. Yeah.
You're making me wonder what European art Europeans loved at the time, and I'm going to conjecture it's Cubism and Surrealism, and did they see that in Grandma Moses?
It's a good question. There's this one of the articles that I was quoting from, and that sticks with me, was by a Parisian critic who was embracing Grandma Moses' art and also embracing the art of Morris Hirschfeld, who I briefly mentioned. He was a self-taught artist who was a slipper manufacturer in Brooklyn, who painted these incredible canvases, portraits, pictures of animals and architecture that were very surreal. And that were embraced by Sidney Janis and at MoMA for their kind of connection to that tradition in art. Anyway, and then they were rejected in America. There was a terrible reaction to the solo show that MoMA did for Morris Hirschfeld in 1943, and that kind of led. Well, I won't go there for the moment, but it was a kind of a bad moment for the embrace and the positioning of this art at American modern institutions. So anyway, this Parisian critic was really taken with the surreal connection of Hirschfeld's work, but he didn't really make that connection with Moses. I don't know. I don't think that there's not a true connection with surrealism or cubism. I think it more has to do, again, with this connection to the self-taught tradition in Europe, which was embraced, again, as I mentioned, with Henri Rousseau and many other painters, Camille Bombois was a famous self-taught French painter, and he went to the Grandma Moses show when it opened at the embassy in Paris, and loved her paintings. So it was more about the European taste for their own self-taught practitioners, and also for realist painters of the past. I think that's really what I saw coming up again and again in the criticism. But I think your conjecture about what they liked in terms of contemporary art is probably right on. Yeah, thank you.